Again, I pour out my the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again I pour out my life. Once again I pour out my life.
Okay, shall we pray? Merciful and loving Father, we want to thank you for this evening. You have gathered us together with a purpose, and Father, we pray that you would fulfill your purpose through the word as it speaks to us. Help us, O Lord, to observe our lives carefully and also to listen to the word with all diligence, that we may truly apply the truth and see your hand setting us free in our personal lives. Lord, we thank you for this word that has been opened to us. It has been revealed to us as we study the scriptures, O Lord. Help us to be more stronger in our commitment, be more stronger in our obedience. We give you all praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so am I audible? I have a throat problem, so I might be a little, less volume. I might be having a little less volume, but if you are not able to hear me, just let me know so that I can be more closer to the mic, okay? Right. Let us go into the passage for today. It is in the book of Revelation. All right, before we go into the text, let me just remind you one announcement. Some of you have registered. Others who haven't registered, please remember, there is a camp coming up from 22nd to 24th of this month. 22nd, 23rd, 24th. 3 days, three speakers. L.T. Jajendran, Pastor C.B. Samuel, and Pastor Sundar Krishnan. Okay, three people that are very hard to, get like this together in one camp. So please come and be blessed. The theme of the camp is Arise and Build, which is mainly for leaders. People who are above 18 can definitely register. If you haven't registered, please do register. The link is there in our group. It is from 8 to 10, I think, every evening from 8 to 10. So make sure that 8:30 to 10, I think like that. The details will be there as you go to register. Okay. So please make it a point that you register and be a part of it. It helps you to be clear on what God is calling you to do in this pandemic and even beyond this. Okay, so what is this calling for, and how is God's power going to sustain us in fulfilling the calling is what the main speakers are going to focus on. Okay, so Arise and Build, a camp for leaders. Please do join if you haven't registered yet. All right, let's go into the book of Revelation. We are in the doxology. Okay, we were in the greeting, and now we are in the doxology. I'll just read that passage again so that we get a clear picture of what we are doing. Okay, Revelation chapter 1 verses 4 to 8. Revelation chapter 1 verses 4 to 8. And we are going to focus on 5 to 8 today. Okay, John to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Right, so we saw the greeting. John was greeting the seven churches. This is written, addressed to the seven churches that are in Asia. We saw that last week. And we saw the God, the triune God, as the source of the grace and peace last week. Right? So now as he goes into verse 5, he's going to spotlight on the third person of the Trinity, or actually the second person of Trinity, but mentioned here as the third. Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings on earth. We saw the three titles last week. And also we saw the seven spirits who are before his throne, the sevenfold spirit, or the perfect Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit seen in all his fullness. Okay, so we see God, the eternal one, who was and who is and who is to come. Sorry, who is and who was and who is to come. God who is eternal. And we see the Holy Spirit in his fullness, sevenfold. And then we look at Jesus Christ, the three titles given there, faithful witness, firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Those are the three offices, that Jesus Christ has. He is a prophet, the faithful witness. He is a priest, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings on the earth. He is a king. Prophet, priest, and king. Three in one. The threefold office of Jesus Christ. Now, this book is bringing to mind or bringing to front these three in one and one in three, the triune God. But the book is dedicated to Jesus Christ, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion. Okay, so John says, this book is dedicated to Jesus Christ. Why? Why is he addressing both the Father and the Holy Spirit, but then dedicating the book to Christ? There are three reasons given in verse 5 and 6. What are the three reasons? Because of what he has done for his, because he loves us. Reason number one is that he has loved us. What has Christ done for us? These three things Christ has done for us. First thing is, he not loved us. The Bible says he loves us. Present tense. Okay. It is in the present continuous tense that the Bible says he loves us. Okay. It shows, the atoning work that Christ has done on the cross is continuing in our lives. The blood that was paid on your behalf and my behalf belongs to this Son of God. And that Son of God is still loving you. The same love that he loved us on the cross, he is still loving us. See, the blood is one of the major themes of the book of Revelation. Okay? 19 times the word blood appears in this book. Okay? So 19 times. Now, when you look at the first aspect of Christ's work, it is that he loves us. Now, where do you see this theme predominant? The predominant theme that God loves us, Jesus Christ loves us, is found in John's Gospel. For God so loved the world. And Jesus loves us. Okay, so that is why it is so stressed. The love of Christ is stressed and it is shown as present continuous. His love is continuous. His love is today. God loves you. At this moment, as we are listening to this, no matter what you have done, no matter what you are going through, God wants you to know that he loves you. Okay, so loves us. He loves us. And the emphasis is on John's Gospel. Second thing that he does is that he washes us from our sins. Some translations say he freed us from our sins by his blood. Some translations say he washes us by his blood. Okay. So he washed us from our sins, or he freed us from our sins. His atoning blood has shown that he loves us and he saved us. And because he has saved us, he has now washed us clean. You know, the emphasis is on, I think it is on 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him no... Sorry, 1 John chapter 1. Yeah, it's correct. In that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his son cleanses us from all sin. Okay, all sin. That means sins that are in the past, which we have already confessed, sins we are committing today or now and we are yet to confess, or sins in the future that you have not yet committed. See, and his blood has cleansed us from all sin, irrespective whether it is in the past, present or future. His blood is able to cleanse us from all sin. So at this moment we stand in front of God as sinless. As Jesus is sinless, so are you and me. Why? Not because of our merit, but because Jesus cleanses us with his blood. He has cleansed us with his blood. That is what he's stressing here. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5 to, I think, 7. Okay, 5 to 7. Now, it also continues there. If we say we have no sin, we are lying. Okay, we are deceiving ourselves. The truth is not in us. So let us thank God for this second aspect of Christ's work in us, and that is he washes us clean from our sins. He has freed us, okay, in the past tense, from our sins. How? By his blood. Okay, again, by his blood. Then, and made us a kingdom priests to God, to his God and Father. So, the third aspect of Christ's work is that he has made us a kingdom of priests. He has made us a kingdom of priests. Now, this is a parallel to the emphasis that is given in the whole book of Revelation. See, the book of Revelation shows that we are priests. Like how Jesus is a priest in the line of Melchizedek. No? He is a king and a priest like Melchizedek. 6, Hebrews chapter 7. Now, the same way, in Christ, we are also priests. That is what he's saying here. Okay, we are also priests. Why a priest? The role of the priest is to do service unto God. And that is what we are called for. We are called to do service unto the Lord, to do his work, to do his calling. You know, whatever he commands us, we have to obey. And that is what a priest does. And because of Christ, you know, we are seated where Christ is now seated. The priest is now seated on his throne. And that is where you and I, we are seated too, on the throne that God has given to Jesus. We are also on the throne. Okay. So, I'm not saying that. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 to 10 says that. We are also seated on the throne of Jesus. Okay. So, there are three aspects of Christ's work that is worthy of praise. What are the three aspects of the work of Christ that is worthy of praise? Listed in verses 5 and 6. First of all, it says here, he loves us. Second of all, he washes us from our sins, or freed us from our sins. Thirdly, he made us a kingdom of priests. He made us a kingdom of priests unto God, and unto his God and Father. And then comes the doxology, means song of praise. Okay, doxology means song of praise. And here comes a real song, here comes a real praise. What is that? It says, the reason for praise is given there, and then the praise comes here. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever, and concludes with Amen. To him be dominion, glory and dominion. Okay, glory. See, this is the natural response of the believer as he goes through these reasons is praise. The natural response to the threefold work of Christ in our life is praise. See, now, when you look at this glory and dominion forever and ever, what is John trying to contrast it with? John is trying to contrast it with the earthly king, Caesar, who claims to be the most glorious king by himself. He himself says he's the most glorious king. And he himself says his dominion is going to last forever and ever. But John is contrasting Caesar and saying he's temporary. This trouble that the believers are going through, as he writes this book of Revelation, we are going through tribulation that is only temporary. Why? Because the rulers, the kings of this earth are only temporary. Their glory is only for a fleeting time. It is only for a small time. But the glory of Jesus and his dominion is forever and ever. Okay, never ending. And that has a conclusion, and that conclusion is Amen. Amen means so be it. Appears 8 times in the book of Revelation, the word Amen, so be it. What does it mean? It means that I am agreeing to this worship that has been pronounced here. ഇവിടെ പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്ന ഈ സ്തുതിയോട് ഞാൻ യോജിക്കുന്നു. സോ ബി ഇറ്റ്, അങ്ങനെ തന്നെ നടക്കട്ടെ. യു നോ, ഐ എം ഓൾസോ കമ്മിറ്റഡ് ടു ഇറ്റ്. ഐ എം ഓൾസോ പാർട്ട് ഓഫ് ഇറ്റ്. ഐ ഓൾസോ വാണ്ട് ടു ബി എഗ്രീയിങ് ടു വാട്ട് ദ വർഷിപ്പർ ഹാസ് ജസ്റ്റ് ഡിക്ലെയർഡ്. ഓക്കെ, നൗ വേർ എവർ ഡോക്സോളജീസ് കംസ് ഇൻ ദ ന്യൂ ടെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റ്, there most of the time you will find this word Amen follows it. What does it mean? It means the writer of that text is committed to the truth that is found in that doxology. Our doxology il kandirikkuna aa satyathinode ee ezhuthukaran onnode thannathine samarpikkiyanam. See, so when we say Amen at the end of a prayer, we are submitting to the truth that has been spoken in that prayer, saying so be it. ഈ പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്ന പോലെ എൻ്റെ ജീവിതത്തിൽ നടക്കട്ടെ, ഈ പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നത് പോലെ ഈ പ്രാർത്ഥനാ വിഷയങ്ങളുടെ ഒപ്പം നടക്കട്ടെ. വി ആർ എഗ്രീയിങ് ടു ദ ഫാക്ട് ആൻഡ് വി ആർ കമ്മിറ്റിംഗ് ടു വാട്ട് ദ ട്രൂത്ത് ഹാസ് ബീൻ പ്രൊക്ലെയിംഡ് ഇൻ ദാറ്റ് പ്രെയർ. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വെയർ ആമേൻ കംസ് ഇൻ. ഓക്കെ, ദി അതർ പാസേജസ് വെയർ യുനോ ആമേൻ കംസ് ഇൻ, ഐ മീൻ സോറി, ഡോക്സോളജി കംസ് ഇൻ ദ ന്യൂ ടെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് ആർ, ഐ എം ജസ്റ്റ് ഗോയിങ് ടു ലിസ്റ്റ് ഇറ്റ്. ഇഫ് യു ആർ ടേക്കിംഗ് ഇറ്റ് ഡൗൺ, യു കെൻ ടേക്ക് ഇറ്റ് ഡൗൺ. റോമൻസ് ചാപ്റ്റർ 1 വേഴ്സ് 25. Okay, doxologies, wherever songs of praise comes in the New Testament. Romans chapter 1 verse 25, Romans chapter 11 verse 36, and Romans chapter 15 verse 33. Romans 1, 25, 11, 36, and 15, 33. And then Ephesians 3, 21, Ephesians 3, 21, Philippians 4, 20, and Hebrews 13:21. Philippians 4:20 and Hebrews 13:21. Okay, I'll read it again. Romans 1:25, Romans 11:36, Romans 15:33. Ephesians 3:21, Philippians 4:20 and Hebrews 13:21. These are where, you know, New Testament doxologies are found, and at the end of most of them you will find this word Amen is repeated. Okay, so the natural response to the work of Christ is praise. Okay, so when we remember his work, we praise him. When we remember his cleansing work in our life, we praise him. And when we know that the position that Christ has placed us in at present, we have to praise him. See, so praise should transcend everything and anything, any time that we are involved in thinking and meditating upon the word of God. See, so carry your praise every time you go outside. Carry your praise with you wherever you go. There is not a time and a season that you have to check, okay, ippam stuthikkan samayam. No. In your heart, be always praising God. You know, sing songs of praise. Let the songs of praise bring you into the presence of this Almighty King every moment of your day. See, nammal sadharana karyangal cheyidondirikkayirikkum. But, you know, be meditating upon what Christ is doing in your life today. And as you do that, give praises to him. You know, that should be something natural for the Christian to do. It's simply a natural response from us. നമ്മൾ വാഹനം ഓടിക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് കണ്ണടച്ച് സ്തുതിക്കണം എന്നല്ല പറയുന്നത്, വാഹനം ഓടിക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് കണ്ണു തുറന്നു വെച്ച് തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ദൈവത്തെ സ്തുതിക്കാം. യുനോ, ഇഫ് യു ആർ ഗോയിങ് ഇൻ എ കാർ ഓർ സംതിങ്, യു പുട്ട് ഓൺ ദ സോങ്സ് ഓഫ് പ്രേസ് ആൻഡ് സിംഗ് വിത്ത് ഇറ്റ്. ആസ് ലോങ് ആസ് ദ വേർഡ്സ് ദറ്റ് യു സിംഗിങ് ആർ ഫ്രം ദ വേർഡ് ഓഫ് ഗാഡ്, ബി പ്രേസിങ് ഗാഡ് അറ്റ് ഓൾ ടൈംസ്, യു നോ, ആസ് മച്ച് ആസ് പോസിബിൾ, ഇൻ സീസൺ, ഔട്ട് ഓഫ് സീസൺ, ഗിവ് പ്രേസ് ടു ഗാഡ് ഇൻ ഓൾ ദ വർക്ക് ദറ്റ് യു ഡു. ഓൾവേസ് റിമെമ്പർ ദിസ് ഇസ് ആർ നാച്ചുറൽ റെസ്പോൺസ് ആസ് ബിലീവേഴ്സ്. ദെൻ വേഴ്സ് 7 and 8, Behold, he is coming with the clouds and every eye will see him. See, a prophetic description is given there and it is exalted, it is focusing on the return of Christ, the Christ who is going to come and defeat all his enemies. So the overriding theme of the book is his coming as a victorious Messiah. He is going to come. See, he's coming with the clouds and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. So here is the expectation that is there, the hope that is there, that he is going to come again. Okay, and so this book is a book of victory. It is a book for the overcomers. You will see that as Christ is writing to the churches, you will find repeatedly the word overcomer comes, and he is coming back victorious. Okay, victorious, defeating all his enemies. And then he will be establishing his kingdom. And that is the overriding theme of this book. Right? Now, with the clouds of heaven. Okay, now this is something that has to be observed. What is there? The clouds of heaven, and every eye will see him. Okay. Now, clouds of heaven comes from Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13. Daniel 7, read verse 13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like a son of man, and he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. Clouds of heaven. Okay, now this is not only from Daniel. Daniel chapter 7 is the most referred book in the book of Revelation. Okay, when Revelation makes a lot of references from the Old Testament, this is one of the chapters frequently Revelation makes references from. Okay, so Daniel chapter 7 is a very important chapter in the book of Revelation. Then Zechariah chapter 12 and 10. The book of Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 10. And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on him whom they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and weep bitterly over him as one weeps over a firstborn. Now, we saw last week that firstborn is a title of honor given to Jesus Christ, the one who has inherited everything, the one who holds the rightful heir of all things. In that context only, in verse 5, chapter 1, verse 5 of Revelation, firstborn of the dead is used. Firstborn is a title of honor. And here again, Zechariah says, when all eyes look at me, they will be mourning. Okay. Now, why mourning and why wailing? So this verse is actually taken from both Daniel 7:13 and Zechariah 12:10. And it stresses on all tribes and of the earth, and they will be, even those who killed him, that means Israelites, they will be wailing on account of him. Okay, it could be because of repentance, wailing because of what they have done, you know, because they rejected and put him to the cross, or it could be wailing because now he's coming victorious and he's coming to judge. So there is a judgment coming, and he is going to be the one who's going to preside over the judgment, and because of that, they would wail at what they have done. See, so the Lord's return to the earth is the focus in this verse, and he is coming as a victorious judge, and nations who see him will be mourning, wailing. Why? Because they are anticipating the coming judgment. Or it could be wailing because of repentance, what they have done. They repent on it and they want to be transformed. Okay, so it could be either way. It could be a wailing of repentance, or wailing because the judgment is imminent, is going to come, and Jesus is going to preside over it. And again, it says there, a commitment to that fact. What is that? Amen. Even so, amen. Let it be. Let it be, Lord, that you come soon and this happens. John is committing himself, recommitting himself to the truth that has been declared in the Word of God. See, so every time you hear word of affirmation being again and again repeated, we can always say amen. Let that be done. Let the word come true. Okay, that's what amen means. Now, let me also stop here and tell you something about this coming. Okay, now this is not the same as 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with this word. Now, this coming is different from the coming in the clouds, when he is going to come again. Okay? There are two comings that are mentioned in these passages. One is coming in the air to catch away his people or snatch away his people. That is what is mentioned in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 13 to 18. Snatching away his people when Christ comes in the air. Okay, I will give you one more reference on that. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 51 onwards. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Okay, so Christ wants us to know that there is an appearing in the sky when the saints of Christ will be snatched away. The dead resurrected, dead who are in Christ. Those who are dead in Christ will be resurrected first, and then we will also be caught up in the skies. Okay, now what is the difference between these two comings mainly? According to the scripture, these two events are different. And here it says, it is only observed by his people. Okay, Revelation says, chapter 1 and verse 7 says, he's coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him. It is going to be public, not a secret. It is witnessed by the whole world. His second coming is witnessed by the whole world. When his foot touches down, that is going to be witnessed by all people of all nations. Every eye will see him. But his coming in the clouds is a secret coming. It is for his people only. His people will be able to see it. Yeah. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 3, he is speaking to the churches and he says this. Remember then, when you receive what you received and heard, keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come against you. See, so his coming in the first time will be like a thief. Not everybody will be aware of it, but he will suddenly come like a thief. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 15. Revelation 16 and verse 15. Behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake, keeping his garments on, that he may not go about naked and be seen exposed like a thief. Okay, so his first coming will be in the clouds. He will be seen by his people. He will come as a thief. And I'm sure that only the people who are born again will be able to see him or be a part of this coming. 1 John chapter 3 and verses 1 to 3. 1 John chapter 3 and verses 1 to 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. Only the born again will see him. Okay. That is his first coming. That is what we call the rapture. Okay. The word rapture is not in our English Bible, but it's a word that has been taken from the Latin Vulgate. And it means that, like an eagle coming to snatch away its people. Okay. Snatch away his prey. That is how God is going to come and snatch away his church. And that is what the word rapture means. Okay, so here is two comings mentioned, and I believe that in God's calendar, the next event that is going to take place is the rapture, and we have no clue when it is. It can happen any day, any moment. It can happen even now and today. It can happen even as we are speaking, and only believers will know about it. Only believers will be the ones to respond on it, and we will disappear from the face of the earth. And we will appear with him. We will see him as he is. And we'll be changed by the twinkling of an eye. We will have bodies like how Jesus has now. And we will be taken up from the earth. Okay. This is what I believe is the next event on God's calendar. Okay. Now, according to Revelation 1:7, this event is going to be, the second coming is going to be witnessed by the whole world, especially the nation of Israel. Yeah. Matthew 24 and verse 30 and 31. Matthew 24 verse 30 and 31. Then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Yeah. So here is the Son of Man appearing. Okay. Now, that will be seen by the whole earth. It is not a secret. And then, after his rapture, what happens? Till his second coming, one event is going to happen on this earth after the church is raptured or taken away, snatched away. After that, that is chapter 6 of Revelation, till chapter 19 of Revelation, there is going to be a period on earth which is called the age of tribulation, the time of tribulation, okay, tribulation period. The period that has been set for this is 7 years. Okay, 7 years. Daniel indicates it first. You'll find it in Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9, verse 25 to 27. Daniel chapter 9, verse 25 to 27. Know therefore and understand that from the going out of the word to restore and build Jerusalem to the coming of an anointed one, a prince, there shall be 7 weeks. Then for 62 weeks it shall be built again with squires and moat, but in a troubled time. After 62 weeks, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Its end shall come with a flood, and to the end there shall be war, desolations and decreed. Desolations are decreed, and he shall make a strong covenant with many for 1 week, and for half of the week he shall put an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abominations shall come one who makes desolate until the decreed end is poured out on the desolator. Okay. Weeks actually mentioned as years. Okay, so convert it into, symbolically speaking, it is weeks, but actually speaking it is 7 years. I'll give you some more references on that, and Revelation chapter 11, verse 2 and 3. Revelation chapter 11, verse 2 and 3. But do not measure the court outside the temple, leave that out, for it is given over to the nations, and they will trample the holy city for 42 months. And I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Okay. And then again, Revelation chapter 12, verse 16, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God, in which she is to be nourished for 1260 days. Okay. All this references are for the 7 years of tribulation. Chapter 13, verse 5. Chapter 13, verse 5. And the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. Okay. So, as you see, this period is already attested as 7 years, the period of tribulation. Okay. The word tribulation comes from the word tribulum. The word tribulum means a huge roller with spikes on it, metal spikes on it. What is it used for? When the harvest is taken, to separate the husk, the unwanted parts from the grain, it is hit with tribulum. Okay, and the husk falls away, the weak part falls away, and only the grain is taken. So this huge tribulum comes and bangs on the floor where the rice is put, and the rice is, you know, pressed under the tribulum with great force, so the husk is removed. And from that word only we have tribulation, which means a great impact, a great hardship is going to come, and that is going to, that time is called the tribulation period. Okay, now primarily I believe that the church does not have to go through tribulation. Why? Because Christ would come and snatch the church away. So the believers do not go through the rapture, according to what I understand from the scripture. Okay, people have taken different stance on this. You can know it, you know, if you Google it on the subject, you will know when the rapture takes place. Some people say it is pre-tribulation, some people say it's mid-tribulation, some people say there is post-tribulation rapture. Okay, but I believe it is pre-tribulation. Why? Why do I believe that? Because God's promise is there in chapter 3, verse 10 and 11. Revelation chapter 3, verse 10 and 11. Because you have kept my word about patient endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world, to try those who dwell on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have, so that no one may seize your crown. Okay. So it's a promise given to the church that he would not allow us to go through that trial time which the world is going to go through. Not just one reference, I'll give you more references. Paul says the same thing in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 10. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 10. And to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Okay, the wrath to come is going to be experienced during the tribulation period, and Jesus is the one who comes to save us and deliver us from the wrath to come. The wrath of God that is going to fall on all nations. We'll see all this wrath and all, you know, in the later book of, in the, when you study from chapter 6 to 19 of Revelation. But understand that that great wrath, God saved us from that. And God will save us physically also from not having to go through that time. Then 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 9 to 10. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verses 9 to 10. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Okay. So out of wrath we have been pulled out, and we will not have to go through that specific wrath. Okay. There is one more reason why I believe in the rapture before the tribulation. Okay. The reason is from chapter 3 verse 22, then till chapter 22 verse 16, there is no mention of the church in the book of Revelation. from chapter 3, verse 22 of Revelation to chapter 22, verse 16, Bible is silent about the church. Why? Because the church is missing. Okay, I believe it is because the church is missing, church has been raptured, it is not there on the earth. And because of that, we are not mentioned from chapter 3, verse 22 to chapter 22, verse 16. Okay, so no word church will come in that passage, in any of that passage after 3:22 till 22:16. Now let's look at the final passage of the praise. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Right. The Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the last letter of the Greek alphabet, the Alpha and the Omega. Okay. Now, why is God addressed as the beginning and the end? He is the starting, the source of everything, and he is the ending, or he is the finisher of everything. And he is in the beginning and he will be there in the end. He never changes. And because of that, this unchanging nature of God, the eternal nature of God, is highlighted in this title, Alpha and the Omega. Okay. Alpha and the Omega. The first and the last. Right? The first and the last. Now, the Almighty is the title given to his, that's one of the key words, key titles that are used throughout the book of Revelation, Almighty. And this name, Almighty, shows that God is not just concerned about the beginning and the end. He's concerned about the in-between. And the in-between is always in his control. There is nothing that God cannot do in the beginning, in the end, or in the in-between. And that shows this title, Almighty. Able to do anything. Able to do anything. Okay. Now, what is so significant about this word, Alpha and the Omega? See, the Alpha and the Omega is given to the Father in this passage. Okay. If you look at it, it is given to the Father in this passage. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God. See. But then, this same title, Alpha and Omega, is used for Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 11, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamum and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea. Sorry. I missed out. Yes, coming down. In the right hand came up to his sword, full strength. Yes, I missed out on that. Okay. Supposed to be in 1:11. No, okay, my bad. Yes. Let me jump to 22 verse 13. 22 verse 13. Yeah. Behold, I am coming soon, bringing my recompense with me, to repay each one for what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I'm coming soon is Jesus Christ. See? And I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. So it is interchangeably used for God the Father and God the Son. What does it tell you? It wants to tell us that God is the same. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are one and the same. But it also is a case to attest the deity of Christ, the divine nature of Jesus Christ. He is the same as the Father, you see. So, it can be used interchangeably for the Father as well as the Son, because the Bible uses it for both the Father and the Son. Okay. So, yeah, I missed out one more reference. I think it is in the chapter only, but my reference is wrong. Okay. So, two times in the book of Revelation, it is mentioned Jesus as the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Okay. It is a strong case for the deity of Christ. First and the last. First and the last is a title that comes from the Old Testament. Isaiah chapter 41. And we will end with that. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 4. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 4. Who has performed and done this? calling the generations from the beginning, I, the Lord, the first and with the last, I am He. See, it's the title of the Lord God. Chapter 44 and verse 6. Isaiah chapter 44 and verse 6. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and His Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. And one more reference, chapter 48, verses 12 and 13. Isaiah chapter 48, verses 12 and 13. Listen to me, O Jacob and Israel, whom I called. I am He. I am the first and I am the last. My hand laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand spread out the heavens. When I call to them, they stand forth together. The first and the last is God the Father, according to Isaiah. But then, the same title is used again in the book of Revelation. To whom? For Jesus. No. Chapter 22, verse 13. The first and the last. The beginning and the end. The Alpha and the Omega. Jesus is God. Here is ample proof for who He is. Okay. So as we surrender ourselves to Him, as we praise Him, let us understand that we are praising God eternal, God who loves us, God who cleanses us from our sins. He has cleansed us from all sin, the Bible says. And He has made us a kingdom of priests, called to serve His God and Father. And this is why you are chosen and I am chosen. God has done it through Christ. Christ has done it because He loves us. Let us worship Him at all seasons of our lives. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank You for what You have done on the cross for each one of us. You did this because You loved us. Unconditionally You love us. And You're still loving us. You know the condition of our lives even today. We are no better than the day that we were saved, O Lord. We still come in repentance. We still come with sin in our lives. But yet You love us. Then You loved us. Even today You love us. And You will love us forever and ever. And because of this love, You shed Your blood on the cross for us. And because of this cross, we have been saved. We are cleansed of all sin, the Bible says. I have no sin when I approach the throne of grace. I have no sin upon me because Christ has cleansed me. And Father, thank You for the work of the Son, that He has made us a kingdom of priests, called to serve You, called to committed service unto You, O Lord Father. Wherever You have placed us, You have seated us as kings, but You called us to serve as priests. Help us to know this calling and to fulfill it in our lives. We serve the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the Almighty God, forever and ever. Thank You, O Master. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.